Good morning. And welcome to worship at Port Elgin United Church. It's Epiphany Sunday, January the 8th, 2023. Glad to have you here. Welcome to all of you. And I'm Reverend John Smith. I'm happy to be here with you this morning. Epiphany season is the season of growing light. As the dawn comes, we rise to the sun, and Epiphany kind of mimics that action of as our days lengthen bit by bit, you know, a few minutes each day, the sun's around a little bit longer. Epiphany mimics that. It's the season of growing light, only we're talking about the light of Christ, right? So the light of Christ rises with us and grows with us through our days. Couple of announcements. Next week, the men's breakfast group is gathering again. So this has been a long time coming. 8 o'clock next week, next Sunday morning at the Colonial Motel, the Sunrise Cafe. And if you're interested, Harry Jack is the one to speak to about that. So next Sunday, 8 a.m., you are welcome. And then after church, we're having a mega church day next week. After church is our meeting to discuss our cough profiles. That's how you're going to remember. Cough profiles is just a fancy way of saying we're getting ready to call a new minister and we have to approve all the materials for it. And until we do that, you can't actually start searching. So that's going to happen next week after church. In our worship here this morning, Jenny Robinson is going to provide music. Jenny, it's so nice to see you back. Happy New Year to you. Louise Jack is reading our scripture. And John Van Berlo and Laura Van Berlo are on our video. Thank you all very much. So because it is the season of growing light, we'll begin by lighting our Christ candle. Our call to worship. When the way before us is long and somewhat hard to discern, God, send your love to lure us forward, even if it is into the unknown. When the way before us calls us to learn new ways and perhaps go down a different road as a church, God, send your love to nurture our spirits and build us up from the heart outward. When the way before us requires us to trust one another and to open ourselves to new possibilities, God, send your love to help us discover the gifts we need right here within this place. And when the way before us fills us with fear and trepidation, when we believe we have come to the end of the road, God, send your love to be the light that will lead us and carry us into a future of shining glory. Our verse is Christ be our light. We remember the wise ones who came to see the Christ. They went home changed, transformed. So may we, in our worship, see the Christ and find his Spirit in this place. May we see the Christ in one another. May we see the Christ in the very young, and the very old. May we see the Christ in the people near us. May we see the Christ in the leadership of our service today. We remember that worship is like choir practice. Here we learn the songs that will carry us through our days. Here we learn about the Christ and practicing seeing his Spirit so that we may do so in our daily lives. Here we search for answers and gifts of hope and meaning. And here we find them when we see the Christ again. May all that we do and say, may all that we dream and pray in this time of worship help us to find the Christ light. And then send us home to God in a completely different light. Amen. Our first hymn is Arise, Your Light Is Come. She made a turkey dinner, and they had gifts, small gifts, and that kind of thing. And they did it for a whole year. And when they got to the end of the year, her kids, their four kids in the family, they said they were tired of Christmas. Which I thought was sad. But here's something that you could do. If you have a nativity set and you haven't put it away yet, you can keep it out during the year. So I have baby Jesus, I have Joseph, I have Mary, I have two sheep, I have a shepherd. There's three in this set, but I didn't think they would fit on this little table. And a king, right? Epiphany is the day we remember the kings, right? The three or so wise people who came to see the Christ. Okay, so there's one of those. And so what we've discovered in our little life with our little grandkids is that they don't know this story. So when they come to visit us, this is sitting out on our coffee table, and it's always kind of interesting to them, what is that little house, right? Who are these people? And so it gives us a chance to tell a very important story. And so for any of you who have kids or grandkids who are kind of growing up without the stories, there will come a time when they want to know them. Right? There will come a time when the kids at school are going to say, do you celebrate Christmas? And what is the real story of Christmas? Right? There will come that time. You can teach it through the year. Right? It doesn't have to just be at Christmas time. The real answer to the question of how do we keep Christmas all year? So think back to Advent. The four Sundays of Advent, we talk about four gifts, right? We light those candles up here at the front. We light the candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, right? Hope, peace, joy, and love. And I don't know if you remember me saying the first Sunday of Advent, I'm so bored of the Advent candles, right? It's the same every year. Who wants to hear about hope, peace, joy, and love? But it turns out that's what our world needs. And so for us to keep Christmas is to live with hope, peace, joy, and love every day. Right? That's how we do it.
Is from Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 to 7. Get out of bed, Jerusalem. Wake up. Put your face in the sunlight. God's bright glory has risen for you. The whole earth is wrapped in darkness, all people sunk in deep darkness. But God rises on you. His sunrise glory breaks over you. Nations will come to your light, kings to your sunburst brightness. Look up, look around. Watch as they gather. Watch as they approach you. Your sons coming from great distances. Your daughters carried by their nannies. When you see them coming, you'll smile. Big smiles. Your heart will swell. And yes, burst. All those people returning by sea for the reunion. A rich harvest of exiles gathered in from the nations. And then streams of camel caravans, as far as the eye can see, young camels of nomads in Midian and Ephah, pouring in from the south from Sheba, loaded with gold and frankincense, preaching the praises of God, and yes, a great roundup of flocks from the nomads in Kedar and Nebaioth. Welcome gifts for worship at my altar, as I bathe my glorious temple in splendor. The second reading is from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. When Jesus was born in the village of Bethlehem in Judea, Herod was king. During this time, some wise men from the east came to Jerusalem and said, "Where is the child born to be king of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard about this, he was worried, and so was everyone else in Jerusalem. Herod brought together the chief priests and teachers of the law of Moses and asked them, "Where will the Messiah be born?" They told him, "He will be born in Bethlehem, just as the prophet wrote, 'Bethlehem in the land of Judea, you are very important among the towns of Judea. From your town will come a leader who will be like a shepherd for my people Israel.'" Herod secretly called in the wise men and asked them when they had first seen the star. He told them, "Go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, let me know. I also want to go and worship him." The wise men listened to what the king said and then left. And the star they had seen in the east went on ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. They were thrilled and excited to see the star. When the men went into the house and saw the child with Mary, his mother, they knelt down and worshipped him. They took out their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and gave them to him. Later, they were warned in a dream not to return to Herod, and they went back home by another road. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Our hymn is "Let There Be Light." Almost every single person who comes to visit Toronto from Western Canada or Eastern Canada will make a stop there. It's a pilgrimage place in Toronto, Ontario. To get your picture taken beside the Stanley Cup is something that a lot of people dream about, right? It's in our DNA. Or maybe you've been to St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. It was just on the news this week, of course, with the death of St. Benedict. I call it Saint already. Every single visitor to the Vatican, whether they have had any religious background at all, will line up to rub the foot of St. Peter, the statue, because it opens the gates to heaven, right? Everybody wants that to happen, even if you're religious or not. I think paying homage to the statue of Terry Fox up on the shores of Lake Superior is one of those ritual stops that everyone must make at least once in their lifetime. This is a monument to courage and determination and celebrates the true strength of the human spirit. I know that I've been there a couple times. It always makes me feel strong and proud and humble all at the same time. Most of you will have your own places of honor. Some of you might have journeyed around the world to find the birthplace of your ancestors. Many will visit graves in the old countries and spend whole vacations tracking down family trees. This is to give you a sense of who you are. Nowadays, you can take almost any kind of vacation. You can follow in the steps of James Joyce. You can go and visit all the sites of Downton Abbey, if you're so inclined. You could take a two-week vacation through the Middle Kingdom of J.R. Tolkien, if those things are meaningful to you and serve you to ground you in your world. So, we're always seeking to be known and to be centered and to be grounded in the life that we are living. Now, in the Jewish tradition, and also in the Islamic tradition, there's a requirement for each adult male. Now, maybe in this day and age, it'll be opened up to women, I'm not sure. These things take centuries to change. And the idea is that each adult male will make the journey from wherever they are in the world to Jerusalem or to Mecca at least once in your life. These rituals might seem foolish to those of us in the cynical West, because we're all too cool for school, right? We're too cool for religion in the Western part of the world. I've sometimes thought that the journey to Mecca in the harsh desert heat with hundreds of thousands of other people simply to walk a few circuits around a large black box is the epitome of futility. But that, as well as the journey to the western wall of the Temple of Jerusalem, in Jerusalem for Jews, it marks the place where followers relocate their life inside the soul of the religion. Right? It is making the religion real to you in a physical way. You go there to find your place within it, to remember who you are on the inside at the level of the soul. So it is that these journeys are meant to help you become a better self, right? A better you, and to deepen your soul's relationship with the one who made your soul in the first place. Now, in Christianity, do we have such a place? Where is it that we might go or travel to or make a journey to that we might find the essence of our soul mingled with the essence of Jesus Christ? So to me, I'm going to suggest it's a missing piece. It's a missing piece in our religion. Now, friends of ours the other day were telling us about the huge jigsaw puzzle that they had been working on over the holidays. It was one of those 1,500 pieces, all tiny, tiny pieces. They worked at it diligently for days, only to find when they got to the end of the puzzle that there were two pieces missing. They looked at my wife and I and they said, "You didn't take those pieces, did you?" I hate it when people do that, so I was offended by the question. Instead, you know what it feels like, right? It leaves you deflated, right? All that work, and they couldn't quite complete the picture, right? It wasn't finished. And so, this is what the Christian faith is like for many people, right? There isn't a way to kind of pull it all together and have it make sense to you in your life. What is the missing piece? And so now, I'm going to answer the question posed by my sermon title, "What do wise ones do? Wise ones seek the missing piece." Right? It's as simple as that. You spend your life looking for the missing piece. You go on a journey to find it. It doesn't have to be a physical journey. It can be a journey of faith, or understanding, or a journey of. That's what wise ones do. So I'm sure that many of you would maybe know the story of the fourth wise man told by Henry Van Dyke. I won't tell you the whole story because it's kind of long, but in that story, he imagines that there are more than three wise men, which of course makes sense. Three people traveling alone through the desert would never happen. Van Dyke imagined a fourth wise man who made a very different journey while on the way to follow the bright star in the sky. Gave him a name, he called him Artaban. Artaban was a philosopher from Persia. And Artaban sold everything he had to make the journey to find the newborn king that all the wise people had gone off in search of. But on the way, he had three precious gems that he had in his pocket. And on the way to find the Christ, right, the newborn king, he spent each of them in three different situations. So the first one was a dying man. He took him in and helped him get the care that he needed and brought him back to life. The second was a child was going to be killed by King Herod's orders to murder all the children of the two, which our Bible reading didn't mention today. That's the very next story in our Matthew reading. After the kings leave, what does Herod do? He goes, announces, okay, I'm going to kill all the children under two in Bethlehem. And so this fourth wise man saved one of them with his jewel, paid off some soldiers. And the third was to save a young girl from forced slavery. So he spent his whole life, 33 years, traveling around, trying to find this newborn king. And after 33 years, he found himself in Jerusalem, following a crowd of people to a hill called Golgotha. And there he saw the Christ on the cross, and he knew then that he finally found his king. And so he bowed down and he wept, not knowing, of course, that he had given his whole life for this Jesus. He had been serving Christ's kingdom his whole life without knowing it. As Jesus said in one place, as you do to the least of these, so do you do to me. Artaban's journey had been a long and torturous one, but he finally found the king that he had searched for all his life. So, sometimes we need an outside story to help shine a light on a Bible story that we have all learned to take for granted. We've heard it 1,000 times, right? The story of the wise men coming to find the baby and giving the three gifts. And we make mention of it in our Christmas pageants. And even though, of course, they didn't come when they were still in the manger, right? We just conflate the whole story and put it all together and make it all one. The parable of the fourth wise man helps us understand the story of the three wise men. It's not a historical story about a magical star, right? No stars that have ever been known to humanity have been able to stop in a place, right? We know this is mythical, metaphorical language, right, when we hear that. And it's not really even about a rough journey across the desert on camels. It's not even about the Magi finally finding Jesus and giving him those three precious gifts. What happens in the Gospel of Matthew is he says, basically to you, the reader, this is your journey, right? You are going to spend your life searching for that which is the most important thing in your life. That's your journey. And hopefully you will find the Christ in your life and it will transform you. The story is all about our search and our finding of the light of Christ. And Matthew puts it right at the beginning of his gospel. It's basically saying to you, the reader, please note, this is what you're going to do now as you read through the stories of Christ. I'm going to reveal the light to you, and it's your job to find it in your own life. One thing I like to do every year, if I can, is to visit the grave of my father. It's in St. Thomas, Ontario, that's where I'm from, in a memorial park near where I grew up. So what I find is that every time I go to visit his grave, it changes me a little bit, because I find that I become more than the sum of my parts. There's a feeling of rootedness, a remembering of who I am, a sense of belonging to the world that is different from my regular everyday life. So that journey is something that I make at least once a year to a place that helps me remember who I am. It reminds me of the most important things, and it grounds me for the next leg of the journey. So this is what I'm suggesting to you, is that in your life, you find those places or things that ground you, and you make the journey to them over and over until you see the light, right? It doesn't happen the first time. Just this weekend, my wife and I have taken down our Christmas tree, putting away all the ornaments. For some reason, this year, we decided to plaster the tree with every single ornament that we ever have been given. And in fact, we ran out of room for them all. Many people over the years have given us Christmas ornaments, and we like to put them on our tree. It helps us remember them. So my wife said to me yesterday, putting them away is like walking down a pathway of memory. Right? We create these pathways of memory that are important to us, right? Who has been in our life that has gifted us this gift? Kind of like gold, frankincense, and myrrh, right? People give us these things in our lives, and symbolically, I suppose, in a Christmas ornament. But it's all of that peace, hope, joy, and love that they throw into that gift when they give it to you that makes it all the difference. I do know that there will come a time when my own offspring will look at the boxes of ornaments that we have for our tree, and they'll despair at what to do with them. And I know that they won't have the pathway of memory that makes them important. But what we have done is shown them that the pathway is important. You'll create your own memories. You'll create your own pathway with the things that are important to you. And so this brings us back to the three wise men. In the book of Isaiah, the people of Israel are finally able to return to the promised land after their five decades of exile in Babylon. Just to make it real, if the people who have been forced to flee the Ukraine in this last year had to stay away from their country for 50 years before they were allowed to return, this is what happened to the Hebrew people in the Bible, right? They were forced to stay away for about five decades. Excuse me a moment. Anyway, on the way back, they were singing songs of praise and just all full of glory, and this is going to be the best thing ever, right? We're going to come back to our promised land. We're going to rebuild our towns. We're going to plant our vineyards. We're going to have fields of sheep, and we're going to be rich and happy and full. The thing is, it didn't happen that way at all, because when they got back there, the towns and villages had all been razed to the ground. Right? If they'd had bombs in that day, it would have been the same as what we've seen on TV in the Ukraine. Their fields lay in ruins after decades of weeds had taken over, and the temple in Jerusalem was a pile of rubble. And so instead of garlands and flowers and the sweet smell of little goats hopping around all around them, they were met with poverty, famine, and the huge task of rebuilding their lives. And so they cried foul. Right? How could you do this to us, God? Right? How could you bring us back to this promised place and leave it in such devastation? Right? They cried foul. This isn't fair. Isaiah states it many times in many different places. And the version that Louise read today, it says, the whole earth was wrapped in darkness. All the people sunk in deep darkness. Right? The whole earth wrapped in darkness. All the people sunk in deep darkness. It doesn't get any more bleak than that. So Isaiah then reminded people how God operates. God loves chaos and darkness. Because out of chaos, out of chaos and darkness, a new world is always born. And so he took them right back to the first day of creation, when God looked out at the darkness covering the earth and said, "Let there be light." And there was light, right? Let there be light. And there was light. And behold, it was good. It was very good. And so Isaiah said, this is what happens in dark times. When you cry foul, when you're encased in poverty and famine, on you, the bright light of God is shining. You will be full on the inside again. And then he says, all the nations will come to your brightness. The darkness will be dispelled and you will shine once again. You will see people coming and your heart will swell and burst with joy. And so the prophet does something that church people always do when we make the journey back to Christ each year. We imagine a future of light and hope. No, we reimagine a future of light and hope. This is what wise ones do. Right? In the midst of darkness, we reimagine a future of light and hope. We propose, probably we have to convince ourselves first, and then we propose to the world that the missing piece in the puzzle of humanity is the transformed heart of each person. The missing piece of the story of life's meaning and hope is to be found when we journey back to the light of creation, the light of God, which came to birth anew in the baby Christ. The missing piece is the transformation of the black box of the soul when it is infused again with divine light. That's the dream. Finding the black box of the soul and letting God's light light it up. Our world is no different than it was back then, as Herod moved so quickly to kill all the young boys in Bethlehem. So too does our world seek to snuff out the light of hope, the future of abundance, our reimagined world. Not so much intentionally, perhaps, as in the sense of overwhelming us with its greed, loneliness, isolation, and poverty, so as to drown out the light. In this day and age, we're called to look face on at the despair and greed and loneliness, isolation and poverty of our world, and yet to proclaim a different future. How hard that is, right? To imagine something different than what we see on the news. So, The wise ones find the place where the little family of Joseph, Mary, and Jesus are living. And before they go in, before they give their gifts, before maybe they even say anything at all, they pay homage to him. It's right in the Bible, right? They pay homage first. The Greek word there, proskuneo, is very clear. They lay down everything they're carrying. They take off their cloaks and they prostrate themselves on the ground. The wise ones set down everything that is burdening them. They take off their cloaks. They bow down. So the wise ones, you see, were really wise. They show us how to become awakened again, how to find and reinvest in our true self, how to live from the depths of our heart and our souls by laying it all down, opening our hearts and souls, and then letting the transformational light of God live inside of us. Transforming us again and again and again. That's why we do these festivals like Epiphany every year. We do it again and again and again. Kind of like this. Howard Thurman was one of the great theologians of the last century, and he said, "Don't ask what the world needs. Ask what makes you come alive, and then go and do it. Because what the world needs is people who have come alive again." Friends, this is what wise ones do. Amen.
Oh,
Today we're going to bring back something we haven't done for a long time, which is to receive the offering. So I invite you to stand, and the offering will come forward, and I'll say a prayer. Let us pray. As the wise ones brought gifts of beauty and worth to the Christ, so do we bring our gifts to this place. We pray that God will multiply our intentions so as to extend our love from this place out into the world like a thousand paper lanterns, and so bring hope to a world still encased in fear. In Christ's light we pray. Please be seated. Let's take a moment for prayers. Let us pray. Oh God, we have sought and we have found a place of quiet and peace. Let us find the place in our hearts and souls where you dwell with your love. And let us open the place in our hearts and souls where your Spirit can enter and fill us back up with your light. Let us remember those who are searching for light and hope, even after the kings and shepherds have all gone home. We think of and pray for and remember those struggling with poverty, struggling with paying their bills, struggling with hunger. Let us remember those who are living outside, those who are homeless, even here in this town. Let us remember those who are frail and fragile. Let us pray for those who are sick or those facing surgery of some kind. Let us remember those concerned for someone in their family, for their well-being. Let us remember those whose hearts were broken with grief at Christmas. Let us remember those in our world separated from family, separated from their homelands, not sure when they might return. Let us pray for peace in Ukraine on this Orthodox Christmas weekend. Today, O God, we pledge to keep the light of Christmas alive in us each and every day. We pledge to continue to seek for the missing piece of our lives, the transformation of our heart that will make everything worthwhile. God, let us place ourselves, our church, and our whole world within the light of Christ, whose love had no boundaries and whose light still shines bright. And now, let us come together in the words Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our last hymn doesn't need any introduction.
Thank you.
let us go into this world with the Christ light. And may the light go before us. May the light come behind us. May the light go beside us and accompany us. And most of all, may the light be within us. Amen.